A very good morning once again. Welcome back to Rush Hour here on Urban TV. But you're in time for the big issue. If you just joined us, go to our social media platforms at Urban TV Uganda on Twitter, Urban Television on Facebook. We are live there. But you could also go to at LeanNewG3, leave a question or comment, and be part of this conversation. Now, we understand that with the increasing number of young learners leaving O-level, the Ministry of Education and Sports has cautioned against enrolling those below 18 years of age into health training institutions. This is news that came out yesterday. We're trying to understand what has been happening, why now, and how do we have underage health training, health practitioners in different institutions? And it's very interesting. So sitting down today to have this conversation and so much more in that regard is Dr. Binyusaki Molino from Mulago National Referral Hospital, and Leleru Harriet, a principal at Nkumba University Institute of Nursing and Midwifery. We also have Dr. Buchana Emmanuel, KIU Nursing Allied and Medical School. Gentlemen and lady, very warm welcome to Urban TV.
Thank you.
So it is interesting to learn that things have been going on and we had no idea. I want to understand, I want to begin with you, Harriet, principal. And how does enrollment into nursing and midwifery or into any health training institutions happen? How does it happen?
Thank you for the opportunity. In health training institutions, we are not supposed to admit students under 18. That is one of the minimal entry requirements. Mm. And then we are also supposed to consider the 5 science subjects, English being inclusive, mm-hmm. that is biology, chemistry, physics, English, and mathematics. Somebody may ask, why mathematics? Mathematics is also considered because, like, when we are giving treatment to children, we are supposed to calculate.
Yes.
So if somebody has little ideas or did not understand well the basics of mathematics, especially for calculations, then it will become very hard for such a person to give treatment, especially to children who need calculations to be done first.
Mm-hmm.
And then for these subjects, one is supposed to have at least a pass, that is for certificate level, at least a pass, pass 8, pass 7, then you go up to distinction.
Mm-hmm.
And those days, people used to think that some of those, not biology, science subjects can be substituted with maybe agriculture, geography, food and nutrition. But that used to be when they were still admitting comprehensive nursing students. But of recent, there are issues with that. I don't want to go into the details of that. And why the students need to be admitted at least from 18 years and above is because in Uganda, when somebody reaches 18 years, that person is considered to be an adult,
mm-hmm.
and can make independent decisions.
Yes.
Now, when we admit students that are below age, first of all, making decisions, we are dealing with the patient's lives, which do not have spare parts.
Mm-hmm.
So when somebody is below 18, can easily make a decision that may not help the patient, especially in critical cases where you need to think.
Okay, hold that thought, Harriet. I want to come to you, Dr. Buchana. Why has the ministry come forward now to say, to actually make it national news that you should admit students who are 18 and above? Because they're saying that after education, after passing O-level, most of these students are 14 and 15 years. But what has been happening? Have you encountered these cases?
Thank you so much for hosting me. To take you back at the education scheme, all plan for Uganda, we have the 742 system.
What
742 system. I'll explain it.
Okay.
So we have preschool, which is not compulsory. It's most time 3 years.
Mm-hmm.
After preschool, we go to primary, which is 7 years. Most students go to primary at around 6 years.
Mm.
So the school going age is most times 3 years to 6 years. So by 7 years, they are in primary school.
Mm.
So that is for 7 years. After the 7 years, they do their exams, which you call primary living exams, PLE. They are given a certificate. Then they can join secondary school. For secondary school, we have 4 years for all level. We can call it lower secondary.
Yes, yes.
Then after that, they sit for their UCE exams, and they get the UCE certificate. And after that, they have an option, whether joining an institution or going for advanced level education.
That's 742.
Yeah.
Wow.
So after that, after the 2 years, they can go to university, depending on the years they are going for to university, that may be 3 to 5 years.
Mm.
Now, the issue of putting an age limit on nursing students, in my view, brings us back to the whole system. Because you'll find that there are some students who will finish secondary school, maybe O level, by probably even 16, 17 years. And they have gone through the whole education system.
Yeah.
Talking about the point of being independent enough to make decisions, this could just give us an opportunity to just think outside the box. What can we do for them to make them ready at this particular time?
Mm.
If you look at other education systems in other countries, Cuba is known as one of the countries with a model education system. You'll find a professor at 25 years,
yes,
and they are professors, and they have gone through all this day because
all the stages,
because their system has trained them as given even students at an early age an opportunity to choose a career.
Mm.
And when they choose a career, they train through it, they are given education, and by the time they leave, they are good despite of their age. The same issue with Japan. You find fantastic professors, fantastic engineers at low ages,
mm-hmm,
maybe 25 years, and they are doing so well. So ministry coming out to maybe around the 18 years bracket, in my view, they could sit back, look at the weak points, and see how they can strengthen them, and because the job world is lacking, and nurses are doing a great job.
Absolutely.
So scrapping off the age, putting an age limit,
mm,
would even probably divert the focus of these students to other things.
Mm-hmm.
Yet they could have had focus on this. So my view is that maybe as institutions, as ministry, government, and all stakeholders, they could sit back, revise, and probably pick a leaf from these other countries that are developing, because once you develop the education system of a country, you're going to develop almost all sectors.
Absolutely.
Cuba is doing well, Japan is doing well, because they have set a standard. They start this vocational education,
mm,
and orientation at an early age. By the time,
yeah,
someone reaches 15 years, because like for Cuba, Japan, 12 years, they are joining vocational studies because they have had a very fantastic background. So putting an age limit on when someone should join school would limit some other students, and this could even divert their options, and some will really miss out. And
I hear you.
Because these are vocational studies, and some,
right,
of these students are coming out to support, get earning,
mm-hmm,
from this, from what they are getting. A well-off child from a good family maybe could wait. They could go for a holiday somewhere else.
Yeah.
But a student who's struggling, they want to get something that could give them an income. That can make them start their own, maybe a clinic or something of a sort, or work somewhere to earn an income. So in my view, this is going to really limit so many potentials.
I like that you bring that up, because it means people might not have other options readily available, and perhaps most of them will end up in marriages, end up on the streets. We'll come back to that.
Thank you.
Dr. Molino, allow me use that name. The other one is a bit hard. You are at Mulago National Referral Hospital. Do you think that they are not adults yet, if they are not 18. Have they come in as trained for training? And does the hospital accept them? And how do they practice? Because clearly, this decision came from somewhere.
Oh, thank you. Madam Harriet and Dr. Jenna have tried to be elaborate when they are preaching the topic on the side of merit and demerit.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. They try to clarify.
I'm thinking you being in the field.
Why it's an advantage, or why it could be a disadvantage. Yeah, but I'm telling you to think that it's not necessarily a topic of opinion.
Mm.
Of opinion, of approaching it to with the angle of my opinion, or this one is expert, is an expert, what is his opinion, might not be of great impact, marked difference. I'm thinking it is important to analyze the impact these courses have on Uganda,
mm-hmm.
on that angle. Because, for example, the article talked about more nurses. They were capitalizing on nurses.
Nurses,
yes.
Yeah.
So, what actually does the nursing course have to do with Uganda's economy?
We shall get to that. First of all, I want to understand you, who is on ground as a doctor at Mulago Hospital. These nurses on training that come. Are they underage? Are they making mistakes for the ministry to come forward and say, you know what, I think we need to, you know, make sure that people who are going out there to treat people or to attend to patients are of age?
That is relative. Performance is relative. It does not necessarily depend on age.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's performance. Some people are adults, but they cannot deliver. Some people are young. But they're delivering.
So with this move.
So the question is because it is not a requirement by institutions, but actually it is a requirement by the National Council of Higher Education. For every institution that being set up, you're not supposed to admit people who are under 18.
Mm.
That's a requirement.
Yeah.
Yes, and it's not only here in Uganda, it is all over. In the US, it is even worse. You don't do a medical course in US unless you have a degree elsewhere. For example, a medical doctor in medicine in the US is a postgraduate course. You cannot come from secondary and go and do medicine.
Mm.
You first have to do one degree somewhere,
mm.
and then come and do this. So they are not in a rush, that rush of joining. So it's not about performance. It's not about age. It's about the individual. It's kind of that individual brilliance.
Mm.
Who is admitted,
mm.
and why has he come? So the reason I'm saying that we should approach it the effects. What the course is doing in Uganda, why do people go for nursing? In Uganda, why do parents take their children to go do nursing? Yes, nursing is about care, health care, teaching
mm-hmm.
people to care. But there are not many parents who are taking their children to the nursing schools to learn how to care for patients.
It's an alternative.
Yes, they are taking them there because they think it's one of the areas, as Dr. Bichara said, where you can easily entrepreneur.
Yes.
Uh-huh.
That is one. Two, the other thing is that they cannot afford fees for other things.
Actually, that is when you ask the principal will tell you
mm.
it's not true.
Oh.
Because, yes, because nursing more institutions expensive. Are very expensive.
Oh.
Yes.
University level.
Yeah. That is not true. It, in fact, you rather go to A level.
Because like at Nkumba, some of the, not some, all my certificate nursing students pay slightly even higher than those who are doing masters on the weekend programs.
This is interesting. This is very interesting.
Yeah, you can find, they are published on the internet. When you go to the internet, one of the nursing schools that are published, its fees is Virica in Fort Portal. But the total, the 2.5 years of certificate, is worth 9.6 million.
Interesting.
Yeah, 9.6.
Very, very interesting revelation.
So yes. It is expensive to do nursing.
So won't this make it even more expensive? Principal, I come back to you. With this move, I still want to understand. I feel like you people are running away from my question.
Mm.
Why has the ministry come forward now? What has been happening? Is there something going on in these institutions? And I ask you, Principal, because you are now representing other institutions, if you will. There must have been a reason why they're coming forward.
To tell you the truth, much as I'm a principal, I've not got the exact reason why they are saying that the nursing students must first make 18.
Mm.
Because they've not opened it to us whether some of those who were admitted underage made mistakes on patients as they were offering care or not.
Mm.
And it becomes a little bit hard because some time back we had a meeting with a commissioner head. And she was like, no, we can't continue admitting students under age. And the truth is that thing has been there all along, but some institutions, since the minister had taken some time
mm-hmm.
without going up to the ground.
I think now this is what Dr. Safina Musene was saying.
Yes.
That she says that the majority of these learners did not meet minimum admission age of 18. And this was in regard to the ones that were discontinued. Hundreds of them, of trainee nurses, had illegally enrolled in different health courses.
Yes, it is true. Some institutions had enrolled some students
mm.
who were underage,
mm-hmm.
especially in the last semester.
Mm-hmm.
Where the semester exams were done in June, pushing up to the first week of July.
Mm-hmm.
And I think there was some relaxity from the part of the ministry because
should
those days...
Should the ministry really come on ground? Does
yeah,
it have
you
to?
Know, you know, human beings remain human beings and some of these institutions were opened by proprietors who are not having medical background. And you know, if somebody is not having that background, even if the principal tries to explain that this is what is supposed to be done,
mm.
some of the proprietors go ahead and even admit students themselves, even when the principal says, please, this is not supposed to be done.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why of recent, very many of the students were found to be underage because this time the ministry sent officials up to each institution and they were verifying students right from there. And what they were doing was to get the result slip for O level, because on it the date of birth is written.
Yes, yes.
So the date of birth, which was written on the result slip, was not corresponding to
the national ID.
In fact, for them, they don't allow us to use national IDs alone because somebody can get a national ID when the person does not even have the school ID for the previous school.
Mm.
And these days, there's a lot of forgeries going on. That's
yes,
why
yes,
we
yes,
still
yes.
stick to the IDs from the previous schools. So, because of some bit of relaxity,
mm.
people took it for granted. they started enrolling
and maybe
illegally.
Because of COVID and they
I
had
think
lost
it wasn't
years.
Because of COVID. Because according to what the commissioner shared with the principals, some of the students had already qualified. And there are even those who were admitted without the required passes from some schools. The ministry has the examples,
data.
Much
mm-hmm.
as they told us some of the schools, I can't mention it.
Yeah.
So it is all about.
So what happens to them now? What is their fate?
Some of the issues were even in court. Others the ministry was trying to handle together with the parents of the victims and
mm-hmm.
the institutions.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know how far it has reached because of recent I've lost track in following that. Then for those other students who were admitted in January,
mm-hmm.
who were underage, those that were really underage, because there were those that were 16 years,
mm.
there were those that had made 17, about to make 18.
And they'll be like, so you go by the next month, you'll be 18.
Uh-huh. Others were even less by like 6 months. So the ministry was like, no, we're not allowing. By that time, some of the students were already being entered in the database for UNIMEB.
Yes.
But since UNIMEB couldn't go ahead without the ministry's permission, they had to remove those who were underage from the system.
Mm-hmm.
So it was during the time of collecting examination materials
that
was when people saw that things were really serious. Because there were those institutions where some of those students were kept at school illegally,
mm,
much as
illegal, the
ministry
yes.
officials had already told them to send the students back. Maybe they come in the next intake. Others are still even going to make 18 in December, meaning
mm.
they are supposed to come in January next year.
Interesting.
So because of that, some of the parents had to go up to the ministry. And being a human, Hajat looked into some of those who by then were left with maybe like a month to make 18.
Yes,
she made them
mm-hmm.
write.
Mm-hmm.
And then after writing, they were sent back to UNIMEB. And then those particular institutions where those students were coming from were made to pay surcharge for the late registration of those students. So some of them ended up doing the exams and they are now in the second year, first year, second semester.
That's interesting.
But those who listened to the ministry officials during the validation exercise
mm-hmm.
sent the students back,
mm-hmm.
counseled them properly, although it was painful because, you know, the students had stayed at home for 2 years.
Yes.
Others had even lost hope.
Yes.
So it was really hard.
Now, let me come to you, Dr. Buchana. Does age really matter in anything? Most importantly, in going to school, in attaining a certain education, becoming a certain professional?
Mm. Maybe to just point out something, I was a former university students leader of KIU,
okay.
which has a nursing, allied, and medical school. And back to your question, does age matter? Personally, I don't think age really matters as long as what that person needs has been given to them.
Mm.
You find that the challenge we have in most systems in Africa and Uganda is that students are not oriented to early education and early prioritization of what they want to be at an early age.
Mm-hmm.
And you find that when they reach that point of making decisions, they are not yet sure. They are double-minded and they don't have a point of focus and all that.
Mm-hmm.
So back to my point is the ministry can sit back, look at the impact of this policy, the impact it's going to bring on students, and just re-strategize, pick a leaf from other countries that are doing quite very well. Because for me, you find smart students at maybe 20 years and they are doing very well because they have had a very fantastic background.
Mm-hmm.
So my point of view is that let the ministry sit back with all stakeholders. They could also do a study to find out how the students are doing and all that, because like I said, I was a university leader at KIU and I was the chief freshers to deal with these young students. And to be sincere, most of them are, you look at them and they are young, they have fears, they have a huge plate in front of them, so many things to do. They have classes to attend, they have world rounds, they're away from their parents and all that. And some of them get that one-on-one supervision because there are so many students in an institution and so that. So most of them lack that counseling and guidance, the continuous counseling and guidance because of the huge numbers and all that. And you find that in the end of the day, some of them make mistakes. But even those who are older, 25 years, can also make the mistakes that below age do.
Mm-hmm.
They can also make the same mistake. So ministry could sit back with all stakeholders, review the policy, look at how they can impact these students at an early age. They, in British, they have what you call early curriculum study evaluation.
Right.
And even in the preschool time, they are bringing things of career. And by the time they join early primary, they are orienting them to their career. If someone wants to be maybe a builder, they'll tell them about building. Even the international schools we have in
here.
Uganda, yes. This is just being taken up by international schools, because
mm-hmm.
the African schools in Uganda
yes.
have uptaken the Cambridge
mm-hmm.
curriculum.
Yeah.
So they teach them these things at an early age. You find them there at school, but they are learning how to build at as low as 5 years.
Which we lack. And is it very, do we need it?
It is very important. Because if you are to build an institution that is going to be skilled and competitive,
mm-hmm.
what someone needs is skills. Yes, the theory matters, but a skill learnt at any point can
right.
never be forgotten.
Okay, now I want to come back to Dr. Moyino, but before that, we'll take a break. When we return, I want the issue of students studying and completing studies still young has been a very huge discussion in Uganda. But then again, they're saying that age is a critical requirement. So I want us to get to that discussion.
Mm.
But welcome back to The Big Issue here on Urban TV. If you've just joined us, go to our social media platforms, be part of this conversation. And you could also tell us what your question or comment is or in regard to our subject of the day. Now, we are looking at the fact that the Ministry of Education has come forward and said that there's increasing number of young learners leaving all level, and the ages are between 14, 15, 16. And then the Ministry of Education has cautioned against enrolling those below 18 years of age into health training institutions. Key health training institutions. Now I have with me Dr. Maisiki Molino, and from Mulago National Referral Hospital. I have Leleru Harriet, the principal of Kumba University Institute of Nursing and Midwifery, and Dr. Buchana Emmanuel, KIU Nursing Allied and Medical School. We're trying to understand what has been going on, how can we move on from this, and how do we, you know, learn, what do we learn from all this? And there's a lot that needs to be done according to so far the discussion we've had. Now, before we took a break, I was asking Dr. Molino here and saying that the issue of students completing school or studies at a younger age has been an issue of discussion in this country for a long time. But again, they're saying, the ministry is saying that age is critical.
Hmm.
How do we move?
Thank you. The question that, does age really matter?
Uh-huh.
Is not the most important one. The most important one is how exactly does age matter?
How does age matter?
How does age matter?
And in what areas?
Yes, because first of all, age will show how brilliant a
one
person
is. Allegedly, but it turns out sometimes it is
so
different.
Therefore, you cannot say underage. What do you mean underage? Someone who is 15 might solve a problem that someone with 35 can't solve. Is that person underage?
But
the one who is 15?
Yes. Still, they're still young.
No, underage is biased. It's a biased kind of phrase. Yes, when you say underage, you're biased. That these ones are not brilliant. They cannot think. Actually, how does, in the health, in the nursing sector, how should age matter?
And when?
Yes, and when. If it is argued in the angle that patients, some patients who are 50 years, 60 years, 70 years, don't feel comfortable being handled, being handled by a nurse who is 16 years.
Mm.
Imagine your grandfather or your dad who is 50 years old and is going to be catheterized by a nurse who is 16 years. In health, we have the patient is key. The patient should feel comfortable while he's being treated.
Mm.
So if it is argued in that line, yes, they have a point. But if you are arguing it in the line of brilliance, there are gaps. Mm. So we should accept it in the line of patient care. That patient, they are comfortable when they are handled by people who are what? Who are mature, like Madame Harriet here.
Mm-hmm.
She's catheterizing my dad.
Mm.
My dad is comfortable.
Mm.
But now imagine a young girl. So in that line, yes, it is okay. And it is, they deserve it. But now, the point is, why are parents quarreling about age? Why are they rushing their children to...
It's not rushing. If my child is done with senior four and she's 15 years or he is 15 years and they want to continue to another, to say, these institutions, they probably don't want to go to no more universities.
Mm.
They want to do nursing. They want to do technical things. Should I stop them?
Yes. So we are saying that what is the expected goal of doing these courses? Why is this student interested in nursing, and why is the parent ready to invest in that much 9.6 for the nursing course to go? Most of them in Uganda, as we said earlier, most of them in Uganda take their students to this nursing institution because they know at the end of that course, the nursing course in Uganda is one of those professions in Uganda where you can easily get a job.
Mm.
Among the few, in fact, the best ranked.
If I could go back to what Dr. Buchana mentioned here, not many people know what they want by senior four. So when you say that it is one of them, you can easily get employment.
Uh-huh.
I want to disagree with you, because most of them, they will argue that, so I cannot afford university. Maybe I don't want to do university. I want to just go here. I don't know if that is the narrative they give, that it is easy to get employment.
Yes, because Uganda, as you know, we are among the countries that are enjoying absolute poverty. Absolute poverty. So in most homes in Uganda, there are discussions when they are talking about where to take the child after O level or A level. They are looking at the job. After what are they going to do? So most of the parents who decide for nursing, Madame Harriet said, that some students are even not interested in the course, but the parents saw that this is where they can easily.
Dr. Buchana, you were a student and now
students leader.
The students leader.
While doing my bachelor's degree
in
KIU.
What was the course?
Bachelor's of Medicine and Surgery.
Interesting. Why did you choose that line? Were you schooled about it? Was it because there's quick employment coming along?
Well, I have a long story where I made the choice to do medicine.
You can hear us.
But just to make it short, I grew up in the slums, and my dad used to work at a medical center as a security guard. And I loved, a certain doctor inspired me, who worked at the same medical center.
Mm-hmm.
So I worked towards that, taking inspiration from that gentleman, and it aligned with the things I want to do. So that background and the orientation, the mentorship, guided me on choosing to do bachelors of medicine and
so
surgery.
So you see, different circumstances lead us to where we are.
Yes.
Don't you agree, Principal?
I do agree, but I won't run away from the fact that there are still some students who are being forced to do health-related trainings
mm-hmm.
because of the pressure from their relatives or parents.
Okay.
And we realize that when we are trying to train them, you see somebody who's not really
interested
in hands-on. They always try to look for excuses for not going to the ward. They want to stay at the school over the weekends. They don't want to work on public holidays. If a student can do that at the training level, what is that student capable of doing after qualifying?
After qualifying. So what do you do when you identify such a student?
Like at my institute, I have helped some to change the course.
Mm.
Like in the recent admission of that was January, there was one who looked to be typical of a designer, and he would always come to class very late. You would ask him why he was late. He was like, I slept late. And the way he was leaving the hair,
the dress code.
In fact, when we were interviewing, I just assessed that student straight away. And I even told my colleagues, I doubt if that student will manage nursing.
Mm.
So when he started missing, you know, at the beginning, if somebody came for a training out of his or her own will, the person will really be
interested,
very interested,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
asking you each and everything. But this is somebody who could even afford to come to class after break. So one time we advised him to go and shave the hair and the beards. The boy went and trimmed a little, but he came back when he looked stressed. I called him, started asking him the very questions we asked when we were interviewing him to enter for the course. Then he was like, sister, I'm telling you the truth. For me, I'm not interested in the course, but I was forced to.
Mm-hmm.
So I asked him, which course were you interested in? Then the boy told me he wanted something to do with the computer training. Then I talked to my academic registrar if it was possible for this student to enroll for that course. They would just divert the tuition.
The tuition, yes.
And the student goes. And he was positive about it. I explained the reasons. Then he was like, okay, send the student to my office. I sent the student, and the student is doing very well in ICT.
Now, this brings us back to our conversation. Does really putting an age limit on these studies really make sense at all?
To me, as doctor had said earlier, I wish those people had brought in evidence to show that really this grave mistake was made by a health worker, a nurse in particular,
mm-hmm,
to a patient
mm-hmm.
because of being underage. But if that is not the case, the truth is there are students who can train when they have not yet even made the age which the ministry wants. But they turn out to be the best. There are those who enroll at 30 years, but you also see that these are people who are going to make the community complain a lot about the nurses. Because
mm-hmm.
you look at somebody, you assess the attitude, the person is not ready to work.
Mm-hmm.
So to me, I would even think that if ministry could maybe reduce to around 17, because if a child starts nursery.
But constitutionally, you're not an adult. Constitutionally, 18 is when you are an adult. So if they're going by that, then we have to go back
to
the constitution.
But I think the constitution can be amended.
Yeah.
Because they've amended many. I don't know why this one in particular can't be amended.
I want us to wind up on this conversation. But coming back to you, Dr. Buchana, will this solve anything at all?
Yes, thank you so much. The point of does age matter? In my view, age does not matter. Maturity and skill matter.
But you're not mature if you're not an adult.
Well, that is that is a theoretical thought. It's right and false.
Mm-hmm.
It's two way.
Mm-hmm.
So in my view, Africa, we are lagging behind because we are not giving young people an opportunity to do the things they want to do.
Right.
Number one, there's no adequate exposure to what they want to be.
Mm.
Number two, they lack the skills. You find that a nurse here, he can't do what a nurse in other countries does because they have the exposure and they have the skills, and these are things they have done over and over and over. So about the age limit point, what I would suggest is that let's maybe sit back and reorganize. Let's give these young people a chance to make a difference. I don't mind about being worked on by a young doctor. What I mind about is, do they have the skill? When they go to other countries for specialized care, the doctors who operate on them are not doctors who have gray hair. They are young doctors who have gotten the exposure at an early age. Putting an age limit is going to kill so many dreams of young people. Let's give the young people a chance to change the world. Let's give them the exposure. Let them get the skills. Let them get this training at an early age. I'll give you an assumption. The doctors who have passed through all these stages, the doctors who take the different routes, nursing, a diploma in clinical medicine, and a bachelor's, these are fantastic doctors because they learned how to cannulate and do all those nursing procedures for like 2.5 years. They go become clinical officers, they get other skills, they become doctors, they get other skills. Now, when you find him alone, he can do the work of all these other people because they have the skills.
Of the skills.
So my point is, the age limit is going to limit so many things.
Absolutely.
There are students who will not join, and their dreams may become shattered. Our health system is lacking. It's lacking. The communities are lacking. A nurse in the community is very important. Even if they are not employed, whatever, they have an aware. When the child gets high fevers and starts convulsing, they'll think, oh, this child needs care. So they'll link them to hospitals, and by that, they are saving lives. So let's give exposure. Let's support them. Let's not kill dreams of young people because they are going to change the world. And let's give them the adequate support. Let's not kill their dreams.
Absolutely. Thank you, Dr. Buchana. Now, Dr. Moreno. Will this really change anything, or do you agree with him?
Yeah, he's very right. On the other hand, let us not lament about the age limit.
Because it is a cap, you're stopping other
our problems in Uganda are not necessary to do a course.
Our problems are what?
No, no,
the
no. Our problem in Uganda is performance. You see, holistic kind of approach to professionalism. We have a nurse who has finished. Okay, she was admitted at 18. She has finished the certificate. She has started the clinic, but it is not contributing to the economy of the community. Yes, so right now we are suffering. We have a crisis. There is a crunch, economic crunch. Yet we have many. The nursing, the National Council for Education has 70,000. I mean, the Council for Nurses has 70,000 registered nurses. Yeah, and then 68% of them have jobs. That means they are earning. But our economy is what? Is down. Yes. So the age limit is an opportunity for parents to take their children to study business skills.
To improve
financial literacy. Yes, this nurse has finished from Mulago Nursing School or Chambogo Nursing School, but she cannot handle finance. You understand? Yes, that nurse is not going to contribute anything to the economy.
Unless?
Yes.
Okay.
So this, she has finished at 15. Let those 2 years be used by parents to equip that child to succeed with the profession. Let them take the child to business clinics, to other institutions. He talks about other other skills. Yes, let them get other skills that can help them be efficient when they acquire that skill they want.
You're advocating for the American way of doing things.
Yes, you first
get a degree in something, and
yes,
then you can go
into
a profession.
Getting a certificate in nursing is not an emergency.
Wonderful.
But if you look at the education system in Uganda, you find that when they go for the nursing degree, that is what they can go for at that point.
Mm-hmm.
You get my point?
Yes. Yes.
It's like saying if you can't afford bread, buy cheap cake. Now, if they can't afford a nursing, because some of them actually struggle to do the nursing certificates, will they first upgrade to the degrees and get all this?
It's like telling them, go home, get married, then when you are of age, come back.
Because there's no supervision at all.
Principal, we are concluding in a minute. Will this address anything at all?
To me, this would help in one way if there were issues or challenges encountered because of the nurses qualifying when they're still underage. But if there has been nothing like mistreating patients or mismanaging in any way because of maybe incompetence or failures in making correct decisions due to age, we can go by that. But my own opinion would be, if possible, they could reduce the age to 17. Because now when a child finishes at 17 years, senior four, and this child is going to sit at home, because there are those who really wanted a course, this child is going to sit for a full year. And if it is a girl child, it is going to be worse.
Definitely.
By the time the 1 year lapses, the child is already pregnant or is already married.
Sure.
And there are very few Ugandan men who can send their wives back to school.
Mm.
Even if you are going to pay for yourself, still it becomes a problem. If you are not strong enough, you may not go back to school or upgrade.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So. Bochana, you had a point you were trying to finish.
My point is, wisdom does not come from age.
We have been told that the adults are the wiser ones.
But sometimes it's the other way around.
Okay.
So wisdom does not come from age, but from education and learning. Once a child gets enough education, because nursing is a skill, it is something you do with your hands.
Mm.
It is something you go to class, but what you have seen, you cannot forget.
Yes.
So my point of view is that let the ministry reevaluate. Start from down.
Mm.
Start from early education. Interest them. Even in early primary, interest them. Talk about dreams. Because you find that most of the parents have interested the lives of their children at school. So teachers spend most of the time. So that's the only point to capture them.
Yes.
So interest them. Give them the career guidance. Give them something to do with their hands. But putting an age limit on this, sometimes they had a discussion in parliament about age limit on adult education, and they are pushing it to, I think it was to 15 years, something like that, adult education. So putting an age limit is going to kill so many dreams of young people.
Mm.
Mistakes can be made by anyone who does not have a skill.
Mm.
So our point of interest should be develop the skill, support them, do a follow-up evaluation. Some of these nurses are very fantastic. I work at Naguru Hospital, and some nurses are very interesting. You find that they can manage a patient, they can manage an emergency because they have been exposed. So age does not matter. What matters is the skill and exposure. Let's not kill dreams of these young nurses. Some of them join nursing so they can get the exposure at an early age. Others wait up to university, but some of them get experience so they can be equipped. So let's support them, let's supervise them, and let's not kill dreams of young people, because the young people are the ones who are going to change Africa. You talked of a nurse who may not even pay tax, but if a nurse can treat a child who had severe malaria and saves that child, that child will pay tax in the future. And all his children will pay the tax and will contribute to the economy.
Fantastic.
You got my point. Eh?
Thank you.
So they add up something and every stone matters.
Thank you so very much, Dr. Buchana and Principal Harriet, and of course, Dr. Molino, for making time to come and you know, interact with us on that issue. We wait to see how that is going to play out. And he says, future taxpayers.
Yeah.
Right, so we are going to take a break, but do stick with us here on Rush Hour. Coming up is the events. Is events promotions a career, and how does it go? We are seeing people carrying out bivuru here and there. We're trying to, what is this? Is this a career of choice? Should I also go to class and, you know, study how to be a bivuru promoter? We're going to have that conversation in Rush Talk in just a bit. Do stick around. Rush Hour returns.